doctor, give me the news.
Doctor, my eyes have seen the years.
It's just what the doctor ordered.
And now your host, here he is, Dr. Mitchell Perry.
Hello, hello, hello. Welcome to Dr. Perry Live. For those of you who have attended the live programs in the past, I'm so pleased you're here, and certainly feel free as we go along the material here to either ask me a question, which will be forwarded to me by my engineer, or send me an email. And if you send an email, you simply go to jmperry.com, and there is a space where you can send me an email, and I will read it and respond. For those of you for the first time attending Dr. Perry Live, the short ride is that we at JM Perry Learning, we are really in the business of all things relationship effectiveness, all things performance effectiveness, and strong character, and liberally sprinkling common sense over everything. And that's basically the net of what I've been doing for more than four decades in this line of work all over the world. And I'm so pleased that I get to do more of these Dr. Perry Live programs simply because there's so many people who have been watching both on Facebook as well as on YouTube who have been very kind with your remarks. So thank you very much. So let's get started. Today, I'm really very excited to walk you through this material. And the reason why I'm so excited to walk you through this material is that I figured this one out several years ago, and I started using it in my practice with private patients, and I started noticing that it really affected people profoundly. And I also started noticing that people use this device to help them make wiser and better decisions. Let me do that again. They use this model that I sort of figured out through trial and error over several years, and they thought, gee, this is a really good way for me to make wise and better decisions. And so therefore, I want to walk you through this. I do encourage you to take some notes. You can always see this on YouTube, and we've also got it written up in an article form. So this title today is something I'm excited to present to you, and I particularly would like to know what your thoughts are about it. This is called Your Self-Respect Barometer, Making Wise Decisions. Your Self-Respect Barometer, Making Wise Decisions. What I notice is countless people out there have real trouble trusting their judgment. A lot of you may have trouble trusting your judgment. Sometimes you're going to go along to get along, and then you regret making the decision that you made. And so if you want to make wise decisions and operate from much more strength, then I encourage you to keep watching. So I'll give you a quick example about how a lot of people live their lives before I actually get into the self-respect barometer. So if you're writing notes, I'd like you to write down being popular versus being respected. Being popular versus being respected. I'd like you to consider the difference between being popular with others in contrast to being respected by others. This might really get your attention because I know a ton of people who are popular and want to be liked all the time. I know a whole ton of people. I've had the pleasure of working all over the world with very impressive people who are highly respected. What I notice is that most people are kind of, unclear about which one seems to be a preferable way of operating your life. And I noticed that a lot of people get so wrapped up in being anxious about how liked they are or how popular they are, yet they find themselves shooting themselves in the foot. So here we go. Consider the difference between being popular with others in contrast to being respected by others. So let's first talk about popular. If you're popular, check off any of these things that might sound like you. You want to be liked by others. You want to avoid disapproval. You want to somehow or another make decisions that would please everybody else, and so maybe you're doubting your own judgment. Often, if you're very popular and you are interested in getting them to like you, then you may notice you're less adult and less mature. You may notice if you want to be popular, you avoid conflict, because you don't want to have any conflict with people because you want them to like you. You may notice that you respond a lot to peer pressure. What that means is everybody else is going to be wearing this particular outfit, and from your point of view, it's a stupid thing to wear, and yet you will wear the outfit, or you will behave or go along to get along with other people if you really are concerned about being popular. You may notice that you over-accommodate. You'll say, hey, whatever you want to do is fine. I'll go along with it. People who want to be popular almost always over-accommodate everybody else, trying to please them. People who are popular, who want to be liked, very often have difficulty saying no. That's very, very ubiquitous out there. Huge populations of people have trouble saying no. Your need to fit in is really big. And you may notice when you were 11, 12, 13, 14, your needing to fit in was huge. And what's curious, though, there's a whole bunch of adults that still need to fit in. For some reason, it seems like it's extraordinarily important to them. That's a popular thing to do, to fit in. A lot of people who operate from need to be popular, being liked, invariably operate from weakness. And so, therefore, because of that, they tend to have much less self-respect, which means if they compromise their standards too often to please everybody else. Now, if you and the other core, the group of people that are much more interested in being respected, then you have a different frame of mind, a different way in which you are looking at how you're going to conduct yourself and how you're going to relate with other people. So if you're highly respected or you want to be highly respected, then you're going to change your behavior. One, you're going to probably want more respect from others. You're probably going to trust your own judgment more. You're probably more adult and more mature. You're probably more responsible with things like commitments, managing money, how you're going to live your life. You're generally more responsible. You probably are interested or willing to deal with conflict, where people who want to be popular want to avoid conflict. You may be okay with dealing with conflict. You may also be okay with being eccentric. Eccentric means, an eccentric person is a person who looks at all these people who need to be popular, and will notice that a lot of people who want to be popular invariably behave like lemmings, if you've ever heard the term lemming. A lemming is essentially this small little animal that has, through folklore, tons of them will run over to the cliff and then jump over the cliff, only because everybody else is doing it. So you may notice people who want to be respected are okay with being eccentric. People who are respected invariably want to stand their ground. They want to face the music. They're okay with saying no. They have little need to fit in. They operate from strength, and they generally have stronger character. So in your network, you've known people who prefer to be in one category more than the other. I know a bunch of them, that a lot of people who I really like, who are very popular, they have little self-respect and they get less respect from other people. On the other hand, they're very popular. When you think about it, you may start concluding that more than half the people you know tend to be more interested in being popular than being respected. Let me do it again. Think about the people in your network. You may notice that it appears that more than half the people in your network would much prefer to be liked and popular than being respected. Then you may also notice that life turns out for that group less than the way they would like life to turn out. All the time? No, much of the time. So in what category tends to be more like you? Are you tending to be the person that wants to be liked and popular from everybody? Or do you tend to notice that you're much more interested in being respected? So let me walk you through one more perspective. Do you ever notice, regardless of your age, every morning you wake up and you get out of bed, and you go into the bathroom to do whatever morning regimen you do, do you ever notice that often you look in the mirror? And when you get out of bed and you look in the mirror, you ever notice who you see first? I think who you see first is you. Every morning you wake up you. You're always there, regardless of your dreams or fantasies about being somebody else. What I always like to say is, wherever you go, there you are. So there you go. This means that every morning when you look in the mirror, there you are. You will always be attending that party, that meeting, and that experience with yourself. So it makes perfect sense to enjoy and feel good about what you see in the mirror. And if you're like many people, the last thing you do is ever enjoy and feel good about what you see in the mirror. It seems to be insane to dislike or disrespect the person always attending the party. You're always attending. Other people will show up, however, you're always there. So it really, you got to think through, if you always are there, then you really want to perhaps treat that person in the mirror with some kind of good conduct. It's insane or to dislike or disrespect the person always attending the party. So, as you think about the difference between being popular versus being respected, I'm going to ask you three questions. And I'd like you to really think about these three questions, because that will help you come to some conclusions about how you may want to make wiser decisions. So the very first question is this: which generally has a longer shelf life? What has a longer shelf life, being popular or being respected? Think about it. What seems to last longer, being popular or being respected? When you think about it, being popular is similar to fashion. 1 minute it's in and the next minute it's out. Being popular means that you are hostage to the whims of the masses, and often the masses can be fickle. There's often great group pressure to belong to the union of fitting in. Think about how you are very often hostage to that. You may notice that people who are popular rarely have a strong opinion on anything, and they're careful to routinely avoid being controversial or strong-willed. They want to fit in, they want to be nice, they want to court favor and avoid conflict. Therefore, the good news about people who are popular is that they're easy to like. They're people I know that I think are very likable. And the reason I think they're very likable is because they're behaving that way. They want the care, the favor, the reinforcement, the attention from others. That's the good news, because they are very often easy to like. If you're one of these people who need to be popular, you may remain hostage to the approval or disapproval of others, perpetually making you adjust your standards and conduct in the interest of gaining that temporary favor from them. Think about how often you'll just sort of, well, they're all going, so I'll go too. Think about this one. When you were in maybe middle school or high school or early adult, you may have noticed that everybody else was going to go drinking and you were underage, but you went anyway. Or everybody else was doing drugs, or everybody else was behaving in a stupid fashion, and somehow it seemed okay for you to do it too. You may notice that people who are respected tend to be respected for a long time. They're willing to be unpopular. Think about that. They're willing to be unpopular in the interest of a higher standard of conduct. Often they're people who you look up to because they frequently choose a higher principle and are willing to stick with it. Principles, values, standards are important to people who are respected. They often emerge as thought leaders and role models. They also think that fitting into the trend of the day seems unthinkable or maybe downright dumb. And that everyone who's concerned about being popular is out of step with what's important. Instead, people who are highly respected are committed to strength of character, and they want to operate from integrity and responsibility and generosity of spirit. So I'll do it again. The fundamental question is, which has a longer shelf life, being popular or being respected? Well, I'm guessing that your answer is going to be very similar to essentially everybody I've asked over many years all over the world, that being respected has a longer shelf life. The price you pay is you get some disapproval from others, which you're unlikely to have to pay that price if you're popular. On the other hand, if you're popular, the price you pay is you tend to be weaker and you tend to go along to get along. So that's question number one. Being respected has a longer shelf life. That's certainly my experience. I'd be keen to know what yours is. So let's go to question number two. Which is more likely? Which is more likely? If you are liked and popular, you will likely be respected. Or if you are respected, you will likely be liked and popular. Let me do it again. What is more likely to happen? If you're popular, you will be respected. Or is it more likely if you're respected, you're more likely to be liked? Well, certainly there's an absence of a guarantee for either of them. On the other hand, think about this. Think about how much you respect somebody if you like them. Sometimes you may respect people a lot and you dislike them. And they're harder to like. They're easier to be respected. Think about the people you think are popular and very liked. It's easy to like them because they're easy to be around. They're fun, they're funny, they're charming, they're affable, polite, mannerly, flexible, accommodating, differential. They're amiable, empathetic, and caring. All good qualities. On the other hand, it's less likely you will respect them. There are people I know and I really like them. Do I have much respect for them? No. I also know people who are highly respected, and sometimes they are disliked, or sometimes they're hard to like. Having said that, the question was, back again, what's more likely? If you're liked and popular, you will be respected, or if you're respected, you're more likely to be liked and popular. Which one is more likely? Well, you may notice, if you respect someone, you admire their values, convictions, discipline, standards, and willingness to live by strong principles. Over time, you may notice that you are gradually drawn to them and actually might begin to like them, even if you disagree with some of their convictions. So, my experience is perhaps your experience, which is if you are respected, you're more likely to be liked. So, let's go to question number three. If you operate largely from self-respect, are you more likely to be respected? Let me do it again. If you operate largely from self-respect, then are you more likely to be respected? Well, think about that. The degree to which you get respect from others is in direct proportional to your own self-respect. The more self-respect you have, the more respect you will get from others. Would you say that's generally true? Here's an example. You get pressure from your peers to participate in doing drugs because it's cool and everybody's doing it, and you want to avoid being called a wimp. So, to get group approval, you consent, do the drugs, and then later regret it big time for a variety of reasons. Sometimes you have to do the right thing because your self-respect is at stake. When you do, you respect what you see in the mirror, and then they will likely respect you more. So overall, it appears that self-respect and being respected is overwhelmingly the preferred choice if you were to think about the answers to those questions. So if you're thinking, at my age, I have to be much more in charge of my future. I really want to have my hand on the tiller. I want to be a more responsible and grown-up member of society. I want to make wiser decisions. I want to be better with money or relationships or just what I see in the mirror. I want to be some kind of a contributor to society as opposed to a consumer of whatever society is supposed to give me. So if you think, okay, you got my attention, Dr. Perry, I want to operate from a position of self-respect, then now I'm going to introduce you to, if you want to make wiser decisions in every dimension of your life, this is a method by which you do it, and what you got to do is you got to identify and start using what's called the self-respect barometer. So, if that's it, then I'd like to suggest this. some of you know about a barometer. Maybe you've heard of it. You may know that a barometer measures air pressure. And so, if you are a pilot of an airplane, or you are a captain of a boat, You're very likely to be checking the barometer routinely before you either fly up in the air or you go out into the ocean. So a barometer measures air pressure. And as you know, if the barometer indicates a storm is coming, then it's probably a bad idea to either go up in a plane or it's bad to go out in, outside the harbor. So therefore, a barometer is a very, very effective method to give you a reliable prediction of what is coming. So we're going to measure, instead of air pressure, we're now going to create a new item, and it's called a self-respect barometer. So unlike your basic barometer measuring air pressure, what we're going to do now is we're going to measure basically your self-respect. So consider this. If you're like me and many people, you probably wear a watch. And if you wear a watch, you're probably routinely looking at your watch to check the time. On the other hand, if you're like many people who are more IT dependent, you may decide, I'm done with watches, and you'll be checking your mobile phone. So you'll either be looking at your watch or you're looking at your mobile phone on a regular basis to figure out what time it is. Now, what's interesting is when you check your watch, and if you're like me, you check it a lot, or you check the clock, or you check your phone, you may notice that when you're checking for the time, you'll notice that a whole bunch of important decisions really are very important if you want to operate from a high level. Then checking the time helps you make those important decisions. So, imagine you now have an additional gauge on your watch or phone. And let's suppose this additional gauge is called a self-respect barometer. Some of you, if you're like me, you like watches. And if you like watches, then you may have more than just telling the time on the watch. You know, and here I've got a variety of gauges to look at, and I also have the date, and I also obviously check my watch on a regular basis. So if you like watches, or you like stuff, like more stuff on your phone, then imagine you now have on your watch or on your phone, you have a new gauge to look at. This new gauge that you know is there. And this gauge is going to measure your self-respect. And what's interesting to do is you may notice if you imagine on your watch, you have this new additional gauge. And in addition to telling the time, the watch will tell you the condition of your self-respect. Imagine you have one of those. What's interesting is if you look at your watch or your phone, to look at that new magic gauge determining your own self-respect, you might be rather struck and profoundly amazed at how much the results of that checking of the self-respect barometer might really help you either make the choice or consider a different choice. So let's examine this. I'm going to give you a bunch of examples that you've all gone through to some degree or another, and tell me which of these two pairs of ideas on how you could proceed, which one is probably going to render you more self-respect. So here we go. One option is you run away from the mess you've created and hope the conflict resolves itself. You'll say, oh, this isn't a good time to deal with it. I'll deal with it later. Or is it probably going to give you more self-respect if you get up, clean up the mess you've made, and resolve the conflict? What probably will give you more self-respect? Here's another one. You buy an item because you have to have it. Oh, God, it's the greatest, it's the latest, and I got to have it. You've done that. And sometimes you'll say, I got to have it, and you lack the money. So what's going to render you more self-respect? Buy the item because you got to have it, which you're unable to afford, or you routinely set aside money so you can build up your monetary supply so you can get the item when you have enough money. Well, I think that's kind of a gimme. Which one would render you more self-respect? The next one is this. You're drinking alcohol and you're driving because you're convinced you're fine. You ever done that one? Somebody will say, you really think you ought to drive? I'm fine. So you're drinking and driving because you're going to be fine. Is that a one that's got a better decision to it, or is it probably better to get a ride to go home and be safe? Well, that's kind of a gimme as well. How about another one? Break your commitment with somebody else because you just got a better deal. Tons of people do that. You have a commitment to go do something with somebody who's a friend of yours, and somebody else calls and gives you a better deal, so you just stand them up or say, I can't do it, or you lie. So what do you suppose is going to make you have more self-respect? Break the commitment because you're looking for a better deal, or stick with your commitment because you want to be good to your word? Think about that. How about this next one? Betray a relationship with little white lies. Think about that. I've listened to lots of people tell me as a patient in my practice, I probably tell little white lies, which of course suggests that if they're big and they're a different color, they're unacceptable. But if they're little and they're white, it's okay. I don't get that at all, but a lot of people think it's okay to lie routinely. So what's going to give you more self-respect? Betray a relationship with lying, or stay loyal, honest, and face the music? Now remember, with all these examples, all you're doing before you pull the trigger is you just look at your watch or you look at your phone and you say, okay, if I do this, does my self-respect go up or down? Let's do another one. Your parents. You are parents. So what do? You either over-accommodate your spouse and your children to avoid the conflict and the whining. You just give in and say, do whatever they want to do. Or stand fast, say no, and remain calm. Stand fast, say no, and remain calm. Well, there's some people I know that are absolutely okay with standing fast and saying no because they would rather stick with the higher standard, because self-respect goes up when you stand fast and say no. How about you criticize and blame others because it's always their fault? This is really popular going on in the country now. Criticizing and blaming everybody else because somehow it's always their fault. I'm struck with how big that population is. What would you rather do? Criticize and blame them because it's always their fault? Or would you like to own your own behavior, pay the freight, take responsibility for your contribution? Think about that. What happens to your self-respect if you actually do own your behavior and pay the freight? Here's another one. Be defensive and argumentative because you must win or avoid losing. Some of you people love to argue, love to defend yourself, love to win, because losing is unthinkable. Well, so what generally gives you more self-respect? Defensive and argumentative because you must win, or step up and work on reaching agreement and compromise? A lot of people who must argue and win think that compromise is losing. And the next question is it? How about this? Stay in a toxic relationship, play the victim, practice self-pity, and stay miserable. You know that there are a lot of people out there who are self-appointed victims. Poor me, ain't it awful? So what gives you more self-respect? To fall on your sword and stay miserable, or offload the relationship, learn your lessons, move on to your next chapter? I mean, these are beginning to sound like gimmies. The first one seems to make you have less self-respect, and the second one seems to give you more self-respect. How about this? You abandon your commitment to staying healthy because it's boring or difficult. You could either abandon that, and now you just allow your lifestyle to wreck your health, or you stick with your commitment to stay healthy and have a long life. But the research shows that 75% of all diseases are lifestyle induced. So let's try another one. Carry a grudge, keep condemning and wanting a pound of fat flesh from them. You're still angry, you're still condemning, and you want a pound of flesh. Or you forgive, you get over it, you move on, you love what you can love and let the rest go. I mean, is this sounding like a routine? Is this somehow or another seem kind of obvious? Which one is going to give you more self-respect? How about this? You compromise your standards because it's easier because everybody does it. You compromise your standards because it's easier and everybody does it, or you stick with your standards because you're calmer inside when you do. Well, before you actually make your decision, all you really have to do, you're going to pull the trigger to make a decision. All you got to do is look at your watch, look at the self-respect barometer, or look at your phone, look at the self-respect barometer, and ask yourself a question. If I choose this decision, does my self-respect go up or down? That's really what I want you to ask yourself. If I choose to do this, whatever this is, does my self-respect go up or down? As a clinician for years now, I've been asking people, in addition to giving them this material and how to do it, what I ask them all the time is, well, if you decide to go do that, whatever that is, what happens to your self-respect? It's amazing when I simply ask that question, what happens to your self-respect? If it's obvious that the decision to go do it is going to make their self-respect go down, it's amazing when they actually have to answer the question. Then they really seriously reconsider, well, the more I think about it, it costs me self-respect. And I'll say, how important is that? And they say, well, it is important. Well, okay. If the answer is my self-respect goes up, then go ahead and make the decision. What's wonderful about the self-respect barometer is it just helps you make wise decisions. You end up managing money differently. You end up operating from higher standards. You end up having relationships that are made of people who respect you rather than you're perpetually being hostage to their approval. Remind yourself that self-respect is always the guiding light. It's always the guidance counselor. It's the mentor in your life. It's the internal locus of control. Is it worth compromising your self-respect when you make the wrong decision? Now, we've all made dumb decisions. All of us have made dumb decisions. I certainly have. And if you're like anybody else out there, you've done some pretty dumb things too. Having said that, as you get older, then I'm guessing you actually might want to learn from your mistakes and then perhaps apply what you learned in the next decision. The thing is, when you routinely use the self-respect barometer to guide your conduct, you're likely to make different and better and more powerful decisions. So therefore, does it make more sense to put your self-respect first? Remember, every morning you wake up you. So if you know that you are the only person that's always going to attend, then how important is your self-respect? It's interesting how many people change their opinion about how they operate when they realize and admit to themselves their own self-respect is more important. You then, when you do that, then you start trusting your judgment more. Remember, your self-respect begets higher standards in you. You are therefore likely to show more respect to others, which in turn begets more respect from them. Remember, your self-respect barometer is hiding in plain sight. It's either right there on your watch or it's on your phone. And when you keep thinking about, well, now if I go pull this trigger to go do this, does my self-respect go up or down? The beauty of that simple question is that it helps you make intelligent choices about what you're going to do. For the same way that a regular barometer makes an airplane pilot either stay on the ground or choose to go a different route, and the same thing for a captain of a boat. It's so obvious, and it just reeks of common sense. So in conclusion, let me suggest to you the following. Learning how to grow up and be fully functional is always a lifetime program. The more you decide to put a premium on your own standards of self-respect, the more you put a premium on looking in the mirror and feeling proud of what you see in the mirror, as opposed to feeling fat or stupid or weak or broke or whatever it is, the more you keep thinking about your own self-respect, you make definitely higher and more powerful decisions. And so therefore, my recommendation is start with your own self-control. Start with your own need to give yourself respect. The more you do that, then the world starts falling into place in a much better way than a chronic habit of shooting yourself in the foot. So in conclusion, please know I would love to hear from you. You can go to jamperry.com and send me an email. I'll be happy to respond to it. I'd like to also put you on our mailing list so you can get our monthly newsletter, which always has a funny at the end. And the other thing I would say to you is if you're a parent or you really want to counsel people, then it's a real good idea to start asking a fundamental question. How important is your self-respect? And they'll almost always say, it's very important. I'll say, okay, now if you go do this, does your self-respect go up or down? You can do it to yourself. You can do it to your kids. And it's amazing how when you decide to put a premium on your own self-respect, all of a sudden the world gets better. It's true. So I want to thank you very much for your time and attention. I'm Dr. Mitchell Perry, at your service, and I'll look forward to hearing from you and presenting the next time we do another Live with Dr. Perry. Have a wonderful weekend. Tell people at home that you care about. Tell them how much you care about them. People want to be told they're loved and respected and cared for. And I will look forward to doing this again, and I'm keen to know what your thoughts are. Have a wonderful weekend. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.